outside. Eat it.
Have a little piazza outside.
It's crazily authentic, which I... Yeah, I don't know what I would really expect from being in Veneto other than authentic Venice.
Young kids go by. We were just saying how it must be really interesting and perhaps bizarre to be a kid growing up in a city that's, you know, mostly just full of tourists and people who have done things like this for centuries. Nothing can change. The city can't grow.
All there is to do is trawl for chicks and boats.
Cheers to Carrie and Duncan. On a honeymoon in Italy, and we are in Venice.
And thank you guys for it all.
So we happen upon this friendship project, and it seems to be a pack of wolves covered in blood.
Attacking Jesus, I believe. Venice may be lost to us. This time on Jesus Allegory Lion. Jesus Allegory Lion teaches the Pope how to read.
Da-da-da.
This one's an A. A for aardvark.
This is the Italy golf. One golf course.
In the city, so I'm going to take this opportunity to talk because it seems awkward to do it with so many other people around. Venice is nice, quiet, very touristy. I think anything longer than a couple days would end up feeling kind of overwhelming. There's also, it's really nice at night. A lot of people just go to the bars that are on the street and get a drink and sit along the river. But that's if you can get past all the people trying to sell you selfie sticks. And what else was there?
Low lights and just things that you didn't know float in the air or spin around. It's like maple seeds.
We also, we got suckered into the roses. We got the roses.
Yeah, we got suckered into the roses.
Who doesn't want roses?
Allegory Lion is our idea for a TV show where, I guess, the lion mascot of Venice, you know, he shows up and he teaches the Pope lessons about life and the Bible. His voice is a lot like Wyatt Cenac. So, I guess if we could get him, it'd be great. Jesus Allegory Lion says, if you're afraid of heights, just grow wings. Jesus Allegory Lion. Jesus Allegory Lion says, teaches the Pope about the Bible. No, both are all allegories.
These are probably all tourists.
This is included!
We've been here an entire day. I feel like we can talk Venice with the best of them.
Venezia.
Venezia? You sure?
Yep.
You're right. the beautiful Venezia.
Ding dong.
Il vetro è composto da sabbia silicea, soda, antimonio, calcio e potassa, degli elementi chimici. I colori sono dati da minerali, più di 200 composizioni diverse, cobalto per il blu, cadmio per il giallo, manganese per il nero. Il colore più importante è il rosso veneziano, una mistura di oro e selenio. Non ci sono macchine, tutto viene fatto a mano dal maestro. Non ci sono scuole, l'unica scuola qui è la fornace, l'officina. Si viene qui e si lavora come apprendisti almeno per 10-15 anni. Ok? Una volta via, we make chandeliers since more than 3 generations, like the one that you can see hanging over there. Today, we have the chance to show you the two most important and immediate techniques. You see the making of a small plate, that's the famous blowing technique. Temperature of the oven is about 1200 degrees. Glass is composed with this material, silica sand, mixed it with other chemical elements. The colors are given by the minerals that the master already organized on the table, more than 200 different compositions. Cobalt for blue, cadmium for yellow, manganese for black. The most expensive color is the red. We have to use gold and selenium. Master is making the plate, and after we show you also the making of a small sculpture of a fish, maybe, okay? So you get the chance to see the two most important techniques in the island. I remember that everything that you see is handmade. We don't have machines. Don't try this at home with the microwave. That's the part where you clap your hands. So Mariano learned this job in the furnace. He was an apprentice for several years, about 10 years. Just to give the idea, he made this job since more than 42 years. Okay? Okay, now we get the chance to see also the making of a small sculpture. Okay, adesso vediamo anche una piccola scultura, un pesciolino. Questa è la tecnica massiccia. Okay, ora miriamo anche una piccola scultura. Questa è la tecnica solida, che come facciamo la scultura piccola. Antes abbiamo mirato un pequeño platito y la técnica soplada, 1200 grados centígrados de calor, la temperatura que tenemos dentro del horno. Aquí hacemos lámparas desde más de 3 generaciones. No tenemos escuela, la escuela por lo maestro es la fábrica. Tiene que ser un estudiante por lo mínimo 10 años. Cuando la pieza está construida, el maestro la va a poner adentro otro horno por un día porque la temperatura se ha bajado gradualmente. Si dejamos algo afuera más de como 20 minutos, se puede romper por el shock térmico. En francés, le maître va a faire un petit poisson. Ok.
Super religious. It's still really interesting to see what a big role the church still plays and the history that it's contributed to this entire, I mean, the world, but specifically this country.
Still, their place is important in the community.
And it's still frequently visited. Really beautiful art being updated. This one has computer technology in it. But most of Venice originally looked like these tiny little lagoon islands. which seems silly when you think about it. Why would you build a city on something like that? This is what it is. There also seems to be a lot of abandoned islands. It seems like a lot of what once was populated no longer exists.
A lot less need for monasteries now.
Buenas señoras y señores, si miran un momentito a la derecha, pueden ver la isla de San Francisco del Desierto.
So that is the Leaning Tower of Burano.
So the lace maker is working the Burano lace, and to make a piece like this one, 2 months of working, 7 ladies. Because there are 7 different stitches, and every lady makes only 1 stitch. To start, there is just a design on the paper and a guide line down with the machine, and then it is all made by hand. When the piece is finished, we cut just a guide line with a razor, and the lace comes off.
It's so impressive to think that each one of these is handmade by several ladies in a given moment.
At first, your typical Venice bell tower. But wait. A Venetian island reclaimed by nature.
Yeah, this is Torcello. You can actually see grass.
It once housed over 25,000 people, but after malaria outbreak, it was reduced to now about 11. Who I hope own the businesses that they work.
Yeah. It's mostly just tourists, like 99% of the population probably every day is tourists. So we're just leaving the Basilica, and as much as I can appreciate, I guess religious purpose, I can't help but notice, maybe I'm just a bit of a feminist, but super, super male-oriented. I was just saying that, you know, like, I can appreciate how beautiful that church is, but when you go in, you can feel how testosterone-driven and male-oriented the entire places.
The pillars,
you know, it's just the 13 apostles again and again, these men, it's just figures of men doing men things, supporting men.
Slaying dragons, slaying lions, slaying hydras.
Yeah. Beautiful though.
Plus spears.
Beautiful.
And it is a one-way canal. So like in normal street, you have a street sign, even here in the city, the canal. We have street lights, street one-way canals, some canals which are canal decided just for rowing boats. Oh, look here, those boats here to the left are the boats of the Carabinieri. The Carabinieri are a special Italian police. So understanding everything here in the city is done by boat, for sure. So we have ambulances, which are boats, firemen's boat, police boat, UPS, DHLs. Here you can see on your left-hand side a gondola. You know, the gondola in the past was the main meaning of transport used here in the city of Venice. It was mostly by the noble family of the city of Venice. So the gondola was a kind of limousine of the city. So the noble used to move by gondola, the normal people of the city, the normal Venetians, used to move by sundown, which is a shorter gondola, not that nice, not that elegant. Look here, this blue sign with a white gondola, and that it means in that canal it is allowed just for rowing boats. You will notice in the city we have a really particular rules. They used to keep the name to streets and squares. It is the only city in Italy where we don't use the word via and strada for street. We have the word calle, which is normally a narrow street in between two buildings, the word fondamenta for this kind of street. And then all our squares, the small ones in the city, are called the name of campo. Here in the city we have a chance of one square, which is Samar Square. All the other squares of the city has got this name, Campo. Campo means a field, because in the past there were real fields with grass on it. Then later, 13th, 14th century, they started cutting the stones to cover the grass, but anyway, the word Campo is remained. So walking around the city, you're going to discover a lot of Campo. In the middle of every Campo, normally there is a cistern that was used in the past to collect the water of the rain, to have some fresh water in the city to drink. So in every country you're going to see a sister and a church. As I was telling you before, have a look. All the facade have got those wonderful facade facing the water. And then even go to those water entrances. You know, in the past those water entrances have been the main entrances into houses and palaces. Because as I was telling you before, in the past it was normal to move by gondola here in the city of Venice. Nowadays, for sure, that we used to walk in the city, we are going to use the former back entrances on the street. You know, the foundation of the city, the official birth of the city, dates back to the 21st of March of the 425, so 5th century. So this city has got a long, long history, and the Maritime Republic of Venice during the centuries has become one of the richest maritime power of the past, and it has been independent for 1,300 years. Up to that, 1797, as when Napoleon arrived here, and conquered the city of Venice. From the 15th century up to the 18th century, Venice was rich and independent. And the reason, because they decided to build such a particular city in the middle of the water, the city of Africa won. You know, there were the people. Watch your hand while we go under the bridges. So I was telling you that the reason because Venice was founded, it is a practical one. There were the people living on the mainland, they decided to move into the island of the lagoon trying to escape from the barbarian invasions. Because the water was the best defense against the barbarians, they didn't have the large ships to move to the lagoon. So those people used to live to the mainland, but move here into those islands because of the water that was this good defense. And then they found that suddenly they said this new world made of iron, made of sand. And they understood that it was impossible to build something on sand. So before starting building the city, they needed to make the ground stronger. And in order to do that, they took some big wooden poles. And they found those big wooden poles that deep into the ground up to reach the substrate of clay, which is at the end of the sand. And then on those wooden poles, they found a bread made of wooden and foundations made of bricks and stones. On all that, so they had the possibility to build this amazing city. As you can understand, they did it in a fantastic way because they ended everything in between the 9th and the 10th century, and all those buildings are still built on the original foundations dating back to that time. So it is a small wonder of the city of Venice. Have a look, here to the right, you're going to admire one of the most beautiful Gothic church of the city of Venice. It's the church of Santi Giovanni Paolo, dating back to the 14th century. That in the past it was the chosen burial site for the Doges. And have a look, this amazing building with this wonderful marble facade dating back to the 15th century. Try to imagine, it is just the central hospital of the city of Venice. Have a look, those both mirrors, yellow and orange, and our ambulances. Imagine in front of us, you're going to see that island with a wall and many trees. That one is San Michele, the island house in the cemetery of the city of Venice.
So Duncan, tell us about the spritzer, or spritz, sorry.
Well, the spritz, we learned about it from a gentleman from near Venice in the airport before leaving. And it just, other than buying masks, this was the only other thing on our Venice to-do list. Oh, and gondola, which has proved quite difficult to find a cheap gondola to ride.
Also, apparently these are the drinks of Venice. They were made here, and apparently you can find them all over Italy, but you need to have them here because they're the authentic ones.
Cheers.
Sure, kitty, good butt.
A neighborhood kitty.
She's very friendly.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, she definitely looks a little pregnant though, eh?
Rose?
You want a tip? Tip for the rose? Tip it,
please. Tip.
Put your paws up so you can. Oh, double kitty headbutt.
Oh, mm-hmm.
Triple kitty headbutt.
You're such a good kitty.
She's got a good motor, too.
Goodbye, kitty. Have a good night. Okay, so Duncan and I have developed a new dance move while here, and we call it, well, I call it the Venice fresco dance. Basically, you take the pictures that they carve and put them into dance. So Duncan's gonna demonstrate a few of our favorites. And the hip thrust. This, my friends,
rough to say the least, but it's quickly coalescing into a dance craze that will sweep the nation.
Oh yeah, we will make sure of that. Also, Duncan, try and tell me that guy isn't trying to throw down. Like that isn't the biggest dance move you've ever seen.
He's grumping.
Right? Yeah, this is a dance contest and that guy is owning it.
Which is the one you want to look for, because it's only $2 and you just get to cross the river. So look for the one to get them. It's only 2 euro. And now home.
How do you feel?
We did it all.
We finally got on a gondola. 2 hours walking last night to find a $2 gondola.
Apparently, you just have to look for the word traghetto. Note for next time.